Hey everyone, and welcome to Exploding Fish News and Politics, because what could possibly go wrong? Today I asked you guys on Facebook if you were interested in a quick rundown on the upcoming French presidential election, which is in 2 days, about 2 days now. And surprisingly, I got a lot of positive answers and people who said, yes, do the thing, with probably the best comment being this guy: just do it. Worst scenario, I get educated on international politics. Best scenario is I die. A comment that I thought was pretty amazing, decided me to do the thing. So first, I'm gonna do a quick rundown on the 11 candidates to the election. And at the end of the video, just a quick summary on how the election works, the two turns, the 500 signatures that you may have heard about, and that's it. And a small disclaimer first, please. If you're a newcomer, read again the name of the channel. And I am all about fun facts, but more about fun than about facts. So please keep that in mind. I am not a news channel, this is mostly for fun. Let's get right into the opening credits and let's do this shit. Go! These portraits are based on stuff that I read in the media and blogs, stuff that I read on the internet, written by strangers, and opinions voiced by my friends and next of kin. So these are made to be 100% accurate, but they will give you the state of mind and knowledge that the average French voter has. So the first guy that you probably want to know about, he's the one who is topping the charts for... he's been topping the charts for more than a week now, and he's mysterious to a lot of people, mostly because he's kind of a newcomer to French politics. His name is Emmanuel Macron. He's 39 years old, and he's not mysterious only for you. He is also mysterious for the average French person. He started his career as an investment banker. A lot of people have been emphasizing the fact that he was worked for Rothschild banks, which prompted me to ask myself, is there any other kind of bank? But I didn't have the time to research on that. After that, he worked for the French IRS. He also was in the current government, which is led by the socialist president, François Hollande. He used to be, a couple years ago, something like that, a minister of economy, finances, and the internet. When I say he's a newcomer, he actually founded his party, the party he's running with, about a year ago. So that's quite new. He called his party En Marche, which is kind of a pun, actually. I saw people translate it as Onwards, which is, yeah, kinda. It can be translated as Let's Go. And also, if you're talking about people, it means Let's Go. And if you're talking about a machine like a computer or a car, it means a turned on and ready to work. That's kind of what the message he wants to convey. He wants to propel France into the future and make it turned on and ready to work. Actually, that's what he says, of course, he's a politician. And there's a lot of his discourse that is around modernization of the institutions and of a lot of stuff. Going into the future, he's a young guy, he's 39, which for a politician and especially for a presidential candidate is quite young, and he's showing for it. What other stuff could I tell you about him? Well, he is a centrist, and that may be one of the reasons why he's in the lead, because usually France has two large political parties: the one on the left, which is more or less center-left, which is in power right now, and one on the right, which used to be more or less center-right. And in this election, the candidates for these parties are the one on the right is really hardline right-wing, and the one on the left is really hardline left-wing, which left a wide open gap for centrist politics in France, which have usually been really popular. And in the past, the right-wing candidates that were most moderate usually had an edge over the hardline ones, except on specific occasion. And same on the left, the left-wing candidates that were not too much left-wing, but that were close to the center, usually had a lot of usually had the advantage. This guy, by the way, claims to be neither left-wing nor right-wing, but thinks that the division left and right is a thing of the past. And most people on the left are saying this means that you are right wing. There is a controversial but famous French sociologist and political analyst that says what makes his strength is that he's appealing to left wing and right wing people alike. And what he is doing is that he is making the people on the left thinking that he's gonna make the people on the right cucks, and he's making the people on the right wing who are supporting him thinking that the left wing supporters will be the one who are gonna be cucked. And that's quite funny way to put it, and the future will tell us if that guy was right or wrong. A fun fact about him is that his wife is 24 years older than he is, which is quite an oddity. Most of candidates who are married, their wife or husband is more or less the same age as they are. Usually you have a 1 year difference, not more than that. She used to be actually his drama teacher when he was in high school. And according to both of them, he is the one who pursued her for a long time before she finally accepted to go into a relationship with him and then marry him. And yeah, it's tidbit of information, fun fact for everyone at home. A lot of people are doubting that he is a real centrist. But I think what really tended to prove it is that this guy called François Bayrou, who was the head, the face of centrist politics in France for at least the past 10 years, endorsed him recently. So that's that. And he confuses a lot of people by saying one thing and next week saying something totally different. But he's not the first candidate to ever do that, and some presidential candidates in the past, I'm thinking especially about this guy called Jacques Chirac, who got elected twice, did exactly the same thing. Policy-wise, two of his big things are more welfare, but less taxes, especially on the businesses. He wants to help the businesses work better, and he wants also help the poor people by giving them more welfare, and that is quite a new thing. Usually these two things do not go hand in hand, but he's trying to make that work, at least in his speeches and his programs. Not sure if he is elected he's gonna make it work in real life, but future will tell us that. That's his two big things: more welfare for the poor and less taxes, especially on the businesses. And he has kind of an American dream kind of a discourse. He says he wants to allow any French person to become rich if they want and work hard enough for it. We know now after a lot of decades that the American dream is actually, well, really a dream and kind of a myth, and it doesn't really work in real life. Can this guy make it work? France is a lot different than the United States, so maybe he can, maybe he can't. But he says that he won't. So that's that. Onwards, haha, to the next candidate. So this guy, Emmanuel Macron, is currently leading the polls and has been for the past 2 weeks with around 25% of intentions of voting. Voting intentions. I'm not sure how to say that in English, but you understand what it means, right? Right behind him is Marine Le Pen. She has around 23, 24, which is really right behind him in terms of polls and voting intentions. So Marine Le Pen is really what you would call a divisive candidate, because people usually either love her or hate her, and that's quite a trademark for her and her party. You either love them or hate them. I don't know a lot of people who are neutral towards her. She's usually qualified as being a far-right candidate, but actually I've been following the American elections and politics lately, and she corresponds, and her party correspond a lot to the alt-right movement. They fit a lot in that definition. Actually, well, I've been knowing them for a long time, because they are quite famous here. And when this whole alt-right thing started, I thought it sounded a lot like what her party has been doing and saying for the past 20 years. And yeah, her political program sounds quite a lot like the one of Donald Trump. So, less immigration, more rights and protection for the French workers, and basically that's the big lines that everyone knows about. Actually, I was talking about the alt-right earlier, and there's another fun fact here. One of the people who worked a lot with her party to help her rise and helped it be modernized and detoxified in a way is a guy called Alain Soral, who is a French sociologist, and he worked with them a lot around 10 years ago, and he is a dead ringer for this guy called Stephen Molyneux, who is a US a guy, and it's funny because they really look like each other physically, and they also have quite a lot in common in terms of ideas and speech. And her line of her party and her, especially lately, have been a lot like the moderate wing of the alt-right. I'm thinking especially about people like Milo Yiannopoulos. It's the same kind of politics, it's the same kind of ideas. It's there are a lot of similarities here. Another fun fact for you at home: one of Marine Le Pen's claim to fame is that she was the first famous French person to vape, to have been seen vaping. I heard that in other countries it's quite different and it's a young people thing, but here vaping is more a thing for moms and dads, and I have rarely seen a person that was younger than 40 years old vaping. Here it's more like moms and dad types. And that's one of her claims to fame. She was the first public celebrity in France to openly vape. And that's basically it. Onwards to the next candidate. The next candidate in the polls is this guy called François Fillon. He is one of the surprises of this election, because when his party held a primary like they do in the States, He was not seen as being the leader, the winner of the primary, but he won, and that surprised everyone. He used to be the prime minister of the former president, Nicolas Sarkozy, for I think about the whole of his tenure. And his government was really unpopular, and he had really bad ratings in terms of popularity. So it's quite a surprise for everyone that he won the primary and got to be the presidential candidate for his party. That used to be quite a center-right party, but has slowly shifted into being a hardline right-wing party. The hardline right-wing in France is, in terms of programs and ideas, I'm not an expert on American politics, but I've read some programs, some speeches and that, and our hardline right-wing party is, in terms of politics, quite close to the US Democrats. And we don't have a party that is as much right-wing as the Republicans, but Marine Le Pen's party, the Front National, is as close as it gets, but it's more like the left wing of the Republicans, represented by people like Donald Trump. And François Fillon would be, in terms of politics and programs, the equivalent of the US Democrats. And it's quite funny because his party are quite fond of the US and the American people. Here we call these guys Atlantists because it's like they're looking through the Atlantic Ocean. And he named his party recently the Republicans. But in terms of politics, they're closer to the Democrats. I find that ironic and funny. Parties, political parties in France usually change name quite often, and you have a lot that come and go, and it's normal here. And his party especially has been changing name once every 10 years for the past 50 years, something like that. They've got a lot of different names throughout recent history. And yeah, they rebranded themselves the Republicans a couple years ago, something like that. So he has been campaigning on a hardline right-wing line with emphasis on the Christian past of the country and against terrorism and not against gay marriage, but because you cannot really do that nowadays, but almost like, I think he is against gay adoption or something like that. There is a strong electoral base for this kind of speech. According to latest polls, there is about 10% of people in France who consider themselves devout Christians, most of them being Catholics, and almost 25% of people in France say that they believe in God. That sounds a lot to me because I've rarely even met one, but they tend to keep by themselves and you know, live in specific cities and go to specific schools, so that's why you hardly ever meet one, despite the fact that, yeah, there's about 10% of people in France who go to church at least once a month. When I learned that, it totally blew my mind, because I've never met one. I've never met a single person who unironically goes to church. Yeah, apparently there's a solid 10% of people in France who still do that, and that makes quite a strong electoral base. And these people are usually fond of this guy, which makes him one of the leading candidates in the polls, despite the fact that recently he has been caught quite red-handed in, I think that is called embezzlement, but I'm gonna say it simply as basically stealing taxpayers' money, which is quite a traditional thing to do, especially for right-wing politicians in France. They have a long history of doing that, and stealing taxpayers' money and embezzlement is not a new thing. for French politicians, especially on the right side. So a lot of people are saying, a lot of people have done that before him, and some of them even became presidents, so who gives a shit? And a lot of people are quite angry about this, with one of the big slogans that you hear people saying on the internet or in real life, or you see that written on walls, is Fillon, give the money back. A lot of people are all about this, and he kind of became a meme in France because of that. And that's basically all there is to say about him, I think. I'm gonna move on. Oh yeah, I forgot to say he has about 19% of voting intentions in the latest polls, and he has been actually quite stable around 19% for quite a long time now. He is probably the least fluctuating of all the candidates. So that's that. Next on our list is this guy called Jean-Luc Mélenchon. Basically is what I would call a moderate communist, if that makes any sense for you guys. He's actually a former socialist. He used to be relatively low in the polls, but recently he has done a lot of cool stuff, like appearing as a hologram in a big meeting in Paris, saying a lot of funny stuff and punchlines in political TV debates, and he released a video game online, and that actually exists as an arcade game now in some bars and cafes, which is called Fiscal Combat, where you can see him punching rich people and money falls out of their pockets and he gives it to poor people. He basically sees himself as a kind of modern Robin Hood, and one of his big propositions is capping all salaries at 400,000 euros per year or month, I don't remember. But basically, yeah, it was he wants a maximum salary, and if rich people like CEOs or soccer players or, you know, popular singers earn more than that, he wants a 100% tax on their salaries after 400,000 euros, and I don't remember if it's per month or per year. I think it's per month, I'm not sure. 99% of the time in France when people talk about salaries and money and what people earn, they're talking on a monthly basis, that's a normal year. So I'm assuming that was the case, and he wants to tax the rich more, to give more welfare to the poor. Of course he wants the state to own a lot of businesses, I don't remember, but a lot of basic stuff like water, electricity, trains, I don't remember exactly, but yeah, he's a classic communist guy, and he's cool and he's funny, so people tend to forget that he supported literal dictators like Hugo Chavez, which, well, we know what he did to Venezuela, and now in this country people are can't even find toilet paper. And he is also a big supporter of the Cuban Fidel Castro, and that should give you an idea of the problem here. He is genuinely a cool and funny guy, but he's a communist. And that's basically all there is to say about him. He is also a big advocate of the 32-hour work week, which is actually one of his best and most well-received propositions. Most other candidates are strongly in favor of what we have nowadays, which is the 35-hour work week, which proved to be quite a great thing for productivity. A lot of studies recently have revealed that in countries like the USA, for example, where they have 40-hour work week and people work usually 8 hours a day. On these 8 hours, they do around 3 hours of actual work and 5 hours that what I will loosely qualify as slacking off. And in France, the work days are not 8 hours but 7 hours, which multiplied by 5 days a week gives us the 35-hour work week figure, and that increased productivity a lot because when people actually have more free time, they work harder during their work hours, and basically it's quite the same figure of 3 hours of actual work a day, a bit more than that, I think, which gives us only 4 hours of slacking off at best, which, if you know basic math, you see that in terms of proportions, it's a drastic increase in productivity. And the 35-hour work week actually is one of the things that made France the one of the most productive countries in the world. It's I think it has been at the top of the productivity charts for quite a long time now, and yeah, it may be number one in productivity in the world, largely because of the 35-hour work week. So a decrease in work hours is what a lot of people see as the way to go, and it probably will continue to go down as we go into the future, and of course as more robots take our jobs, which brings us to the next candidate. By the way, Jean-Luc Mélenchon is really close to François Fillon in the polls. He has nowadays around the same amount, 19% of voting intentions in the latest polls. So the next candidate in the polls is this guy called Benoît Hamon. He is one of the other surprises of this election. He also won his party's primary, despite what everyone thought. He surprised everyone by winning the primaries. He represents one of the biggest political forces in France, which is the Socialist Party, which has been probably the biggest force politically in France since the 1980s. And it's quite surprising how low his score is, because the Socialist Party usually makes around 20 to 25% of voting intentions, and he is only at 7.5%. This is due to a lot of factors. First, this is due to the fact that currently we have a government and a president that are of this party, the Socialist Party, and they're doing a really bad job according to most people. They're super low in the polls, and they're really not well liked, and since he is from the same party that the people want out, they of course already are prejudiced against him. I have heard a lot of people saying that he was the puppet of the old elite, and despite his young age, a representant of past politics, which is actually quite weird, because a lot of his policies are kind of, I would say, futuristic. For example, he wants to tax robots to create a basic human income, which actually I've heard a lot of people talking about this kind of thing, but most of the time they're kind of techies or people who work in computers or internet or that kind of thing. I think Elon Musk, the CEO of Tesla, and maybe Richard Branson too, have said a lot of stuff in that direction. He is also in favor of legalizing weed, which is a polarizing thing. About 50% of people in France smoke weed once in a while, with almost 10% of regular smokers. And actually, the whole weed legalization thing doesn't seem to bother a lot of people in real life, but the media have made fun a lot of him because of that. So that's that. He is also in favor of the 28-hour work week, which is like we have now, 7-hour work days, but only 4 days a week, which is probably what is gonna happen anyway, sooner or later in the future. It's, as I said earlier, shorter work weeks and shorter work days. At least one of those is pretty much the way to go, as our jobs get less demanding and as robots take more of them, and that may be also a solution against unemployment. At least that's what a lot of people say. A few other reasons why he is so unpopular are the fact that he started his campaign really late compared to the other candidates. He started way later than everyone else, which of course other people who were already running and saying a lot of stuff and gathering a lot of support, and really he started much later than everyone else, and that really handicapped him. And another reason is that the leaders of his party, the moderate left socialist party, refused to support him. Usually when a party has a candidate, they support this candidate. That's what usually happens. And that's not happening at all this time. The Socialist Party actually is slowly drifting more to the right wing, and they would rather support the centrist Emmanuel Macron rather than their own candidate that they see as too left wing, because he represents really the left wing of the Socialist Party, and he, for most of the socialist elite and leaders and the big names of the party, he's too left-wing for them, and they are gravitating slowly towards the center, so they would rather support the centrist candidate. And that's what happened, and that's he doesn't get any support from his own party. That's one of the reasons why he's doing so bad in the polls. And also, he's way less charismatic than the other guys. He is quite not really a funny dude, and quite a serious man. And in France, having humor, making jokes and all that is really important. There, some candidates have been elected in the past just because they were good at making people laugh. I'm not stretching out here. It's literally what happened to especially this guy that I talked about earlier, called Jacques Chirac. He basically won the vote in I think 1995, because main reason was that because people thought he was funny. And Mélenchon is funny, that's why he's so high in the polls despite being a communist. And yeah, Marine Le Pen is quite funny, she makes punchlines and everything. Macron tries to make a lot of jokes, and he always says that he's a fan of comedy movies and all that. And that's actually, it seems difficult to understand for a lot of people, and some around the world and internationally. And some people, sometimes they look at French politics and they don't understand why some guy is so high in the polls and why they're winning. And usually it's just because they're funny, and just because of the same principle. Sometimes some candidates are quite low in the polls, and it's because they're not funny and too serious. And that's a lot of people outside of France don't understand that, and that's kind of how it works. Which brings us to the next candidate, which is a guy called Nicolas Dupont-Aignan. Nicolas Dupont-Aignan is kind of a weird candidate. He used to be part, for a long time, of the mainstream right political party, the one that François Fillon is the candidate of, which used to have many names in the past and whatever. And he is a lot about tradition, but he is a lot about modernity too, and that confuses a lot of people, myself included. Nobody really knows if he is moderate right or hardline right wing. And he is all about sovereignty, the sovereignty of the nation. That's the most important part of his program, is he wants France to be sovereign. Just like most other candidates, he wants the country to get out of NATO, or I don't know if you say NATO or N-A-T-O, but you know, that thing. The majority of other candidates want out too. He is against the European Union and wants to get out, just like pretty much every other candidate. I think maybe 9 out of 11 want that. Getting out of the European Union is really popular in France in the right wing as much as in the left wing. And yeah, he sees himself as the successor of the General Charles de Gaulle, the guy who won the war against the Nazis in 1945 and became after that president for a really long time. And yeah, he, at the end of his career, General de Gaulle became quite unpopular because of the war that he waged against the colonized nation of Algeria, and because he was seen as a sexist and against young people. And actually, General de Gaulle is the reason why there have been huge riots in 1968, mostly about women's rights and young people's rights and all that. And that precipitated a huge shift in French politics in 1968, kind of in mirror to the hippie movement against Vietnam War, which was at the same time in the United States, and the same movement existed in a lot of countries at the same time. Whatever, he is making about 4% in the polls. And that brings us to the next candidate. She is called Philippe Poutou. And it's quite a funny name, because Poutou in France is a childish slang term for a kiss that could be translated by kissy or smacko or something like that. And one of his characteristics is that he is always smiling. And because of that, and because of his name, he has become kind of a meme also in French politics. And people see him as a candidate of good mood and fun, because he's always smiling and has a cute name. He's actually the candidate of the biggest hardline communist party in France, called the new anti-capitalist party, which used to be quite big, making usually around 5% in the polls when it was led by the very charismatic Olivier Besancenot. But since this guy left, the party kind of crashed, and a lot of his voters have been recuperated by Jean-Luc Mélenchon. The party, actually, this party used to have a really catchy slogan, is "Our lives are worth more than their profits." Whatever you think about them, I'm not a big fan myself of communism, but who cares? I think that slogan was hella catchy. Really, really catchy stuff. And they simplified their slogan, and now their new slogan is just "Our lives, not their profits." I think it works really less well. That may be one of the causes why his party lost more than half of their user base, going from around 5% in the polls in the past to around 2% in the polls right now. He is a hardline communist guy against capitalism, and that really sums up his party and political line. That's all there is to say. Really, I've got a rat problem. I gotta check that. Be back in 30 seconds. So, next person in the polls. Actually, all the other candidates have around 1% of voting intentions, and they are less well known than these six. So we have five left. I'm gonna do them quick. There is this guy called Jacques Cheminade. Basically, he wants France to colonize Mars. I mean, he has been talking about a lot of other stuff, but that's his big thing. Actually, that used to be his big thing because he already was a candidate in the president election. But that's what most people remember about him. He wants France to colonize Mars. That's about it. He also is one of the biggest conspiracy theorists in the world, maybe. He belongs to the school of thought that was founded by a guy called La Rouche, from Argentina, I think. Yeah, he's kind of a Alex Jones kind of guy. Kind of weird dude. And one of his biggest things this year is that he is against finance, which used to be really popular about 5 years ago. Actually, François Hollande, the current president, won the election basically by saying that he would go to war against finance, against shareholders, against investment banks, and there was this really popular slang term who was banksters, was a portmanteau of bankers and gangsters, and that a lot of candidates were raving about last time. And soon after that, people realized that they didn't really know why they were angry about the finance. Next candidate is called Nathalie Arthaud. She is from another hardline communist party, which is called Workers' Struggle. And basically, she has a hardline communist political stance. That's not much stuff to say about it. There is this guy called, what the fuck is his name already? Asselineau. This Asselineau guy is super popular on the internet, but not a lot of people actually know him. He has kind of a cultish following, actually. I've encountered some of the people who wanted to vote for him, and there were much more like fanboys than usually people who want to vote for candidates. And he's saying a lot of stuff against the elite and the establishment, and he poses himself as the real anti-establishment candidate. And he is kind of like Nicolas Dupont-Aignan. Nobody really knows if he's moderate right-wing or hardline right-wing. And a lot of people don't like him because he takes himself too seriously and he is smug. I cannot find another word to describe him than smug. He is really smug, and because of that, he will probably never be popular. He says a lot of stuff. Some sounds legit, some of it really doesn't. That's all I can say about him. Really, there is a last candidate on the candidates list. He's called Jean Lassalle, and the first time I heard about him was when I was doing research for this video. Never heard about him before. His face vaguely rings a bell. Apparently, he has gotten himself famous for doing a hunger strike against Japanese companies who didn't do enough jobs in France. I don't remember. It's weird. And I asked my girlfriend about him because she is much more involved than me in politics and news, and she usually knows more about the candidates and politics and what is happening right now. And she said to me that she didn't know either who this guy is, but that she heard that he was an asshole, but she isn't sure that it was about him. So that's the best I got about this guy called Jean Lassalle, who is probably the last in the polls, and he's got less than 1% of voting intentions. So that's another fun fact. Which, I'm not sure that's a fun fact, but it's the first time in decades that the Green Party doesn't have a candidate in the elections. That's for two reasons. That because they allied themselves with the socialist candidate Benoît Hamon, and also because nowadays everyone in France, from left wing to right wing, is talking about climate change and pollution and the ozone layer, and it kind of became less politicized and more everyone's problem, and pretty much everyone is talking about it. So yeah, the Green Party kind of lost its purpose and its raison d'être. So it's kind of disappearing because everyone's worried about the planet now. So I think that's probably a cool thing. Not sure, but that's what is happening. So now a quick rundown on how the election works. First, the candidates must all have 500 signatures from people who are right now elected, who have an elected mandate. So you get to find 500 of those, and they're gonna sign a paper attesting that you are a serious candidate. In the past it used to be 100, and now it's 500, because despite of the 100, there used to be some funny candidates in the election. I especially remember one guy who wanted to cure unemployment in France using the technique of yoga flight, which is basically people doing some weird yoga stuff and jumping around in fields, and he thought that was the cure to unemployment and bad economy in France. And he had a party which was called the Party of Natural Law. And you were probably saying something like, aha, it's kind of the French Vermin Supreme. But contrary to Vermin Supreme, this guy was actually quite serious about his stuff. And so now every candidate must gather 500 signatures from elected people. And yeah, some people see it as good, some people see it as bad, because it's harder for new parties to form, and it kind of, you know, creates the conditions for an establishment to arise, which was what people called the system here. What is called in France the system is what is called in English-speaking country the establishment. And a lot of people are against that, but that's how it works. And yeah, next there is the election itself, which is in two rounds. The first round is in a couple days. I heard that in some countries the election are on weekdays, which sound really weird to me. Of course, in France the elections are on Sundays, which Sundays is the day it's basically not allowed to work. People are basically not allowed to work on Sundays here. This is a bit more complicated than that, but so the first round of the election is on Sunday in a couple days, and if one of the candidates manages to get 50% of the popular vote or more, he is automatically elected. But history taught us that this basically never happens. And what happens usually is that the two candidates that come out on top, usually that have around 20% of votes, will then go to the second round, which is in early May. And the candidate, the second round is basically one-on-one, so the candidate that has the most votes wins. So according to all polls, Emmanuel Macron and Marine Le Pen are on top, but this year there is a lot of uncertainty in the polls, and a lot of people said that they are not sure of who they want to vote for. So really, François Fillon or Jean-Luc Mélenchon could come out on top. It's really uncertain, and it's gonna probably be a surprise for everyone. Although in France, the polls are usually really quite precise. I've looked at the polls for past years. Some candidates are usually favored. I noticed that Jean-Luc Mélenchon in the past elections had about 16 to 17% in the polls, but in the actual election, he only had about 10% of votes. But usually for most candidates, it's pretty precise. So will it be a surprise? Will it not be a surprise? We're gonna know that. We're gonna know that in a couple days now, less than 2 days actually. And if you have any questions, put them in the comments, and I'm gonna answer them. If there is a lot of questions that seem important, I'm gonna answer them in a follow-up video. If there isn't, and if I've said everything that you wanted to know, then that's super cool. What else? Don't forget to subscribe if that was interesting. If there is a lot of positive feedback for this video, I'm gonna make other ones, maybe about French politics, maybe about history or past politics or some shit like that. Tell me what you guys are interested in. I know a lot of stuff about a lot of stuff. And don't forget to subscribe if you liked it, and don't forget to give a thumbs up if that was good, and don't give a thumbs down or do, and if you do, don't forget to explain why, so I can make the upcoming videos better. And if you really liked what I do, consider a monthly donation, consider subscribing to my Patreon. The link is in the video description. That's about it. If I forgot something, please tell me in the comments, and I will make a follow-up video. If that was cool, awesome. And anyway, see y'all very soon.